Silligurke hier auf Lasergurkenland mit der Domain sillihuhn.com. Gratis erreichbar, immer joinen. Dies ist immer noch eine Dauerwerbesendung für diesen gratis erreichbaren Server. Und wir geben uns jetzt den Talk. Boah, was ist das denn für ein Titel? Das ist kein DEFCON Talk, sondern der letzte Talk hat mich neugierig gemacht, was Risk 5 angeht. Und dann habe ich mir diesen Talk rausgesucht vom Fedora Project. Das Video heißt Fedora Risk 5 64-Bit A 3-Year-Long Journey von David Abdurachamanov. Ach du Scheiße, okay, also ja, ne, von David. F-Log 2019, ich habe keine Ahnung, was F-Log ist, wahrscheinlich irgendein Fedora-Event, keine Ahnung. Ist von 2019, wie der Titel suggested. Ah, hier sind Leute, okay. Ja, genau, und dann geht es jetzt auch schon los mit diesem Video. Oh Gott, das ist ein bisschen leise, wahrscheinlich hört man wieder gar nichts bei euch.
Module, it's very extensively CPU instruction set. Okay, it started in the University of California, Berkeley, and we now have RISC V Foundation, and started 2019 or 18 fully managing the specification. So it's moved into a foundation with multiple members, different companies, different universities, collaborating on the specification, releasing, ratifying it, having different working groups to develop it. Not anymore within a single university, with some contributors, it has a clear framework how it's being managed. So again, the spec is fully open, so it's a GC license, so anyone can take the spec. There are multiple specifications, there is a private user mode, the debug specifications, which describe different parts. The RISC V targets everything from very, very small
Boah, ich bin's ein Noob. Aber meine Rüstung ist nicht schlecht. Früher als ich dachte.
So while the spec is fully open, anyone can take it, anyone can write the course, and there are multiple people who wrote their own course, it doesn't mean that it's supposed to be the same suite. So for example, SciFi has a rocket course that was in use. It's fully open source. There's another boom core, which is also an order of the core, which is also based on rocket open source. There's a pull project in Europe from between Switzerland and Italy, I think, which you have a pull organization. They have But again, it doesn't mean. For example, Esperanto company, which is designing the world, probably the most powerful RISC-V chip with many cores and targeting AI, I don't think that is, well, they're basing some of the work from the boom, but it's probably not going to be, you know, open source as a commercial product. So, yes.
Ah, das macht nur Sinn, wenn das eins tief ist. Ja, das ist kein Lilypad. Ja, klar.
Probably not in a very good way. So I haven't followed what was happening with Open Power Foundation. So I think you can now contribute, and the Power 10 chip is going to have some contribution to Open Power. I guess that's the direction they're taking. RISC-V has, so it defines the spec with different extensions. I'm going to show it in a few slides. But you're also allowed to do your own extension. So your own proprietary extension if you need it. So it's fully modular. So the base instruction set allows for you to do 64 bits and 128 bits. Of course, the only two that match 32 is 64 bits, 128 bits is not fully frozen. And at least the Duo RISC-V, what we are focusing on is pure 64 bit. So 32 bit ABI is not frozen, so it was just a GLC release 2.30, and that didn't make the final RISC 32 bit changes, so that's another 6 to 12 months probably before it's going to be frozen. The way it's done is that, so all these 32, 64, 128 bits.
What?
So that means you cannot run 32 bit atoms for this time. You probably can build a chip that has two different modes, but again, there's no like compatibility mode, there's no mode to it. It's just pure 64 bit or pure 32 bit or pure 128 bit or whatever. So that's a nice thing for people who don't like to have multiple to it. So the way that the licensing is done or compliance is done in RISC-V, you have to become a member. There are different levels of becoming a member. It gives you different rights. And once you become a member, you'll
see what's so weird, Neo, oder?
RISC-V trademarks.
Ah.
You know, RISC-V compliance.
Kenn diese Struktur gar nicht.
So this is how it's being handled. Because anyone can take in RISC-V, because it's open source, they do some kind of the changes. The RISC-V base that might not be RISC-V compliant chip. So that is being done and managed through RISC-V Foundation, you know, becoming a member, and then you have a right to become RISC-V compliant chip if you make one. And just a few days ago, and I think yesterday, it's been public, that Red Hat is finally joining RISC-V Foundation, which is very nice. So again, it's very, very modular, so just, you know, a look of what it is. So we have a base instruction set. So again, RV32i, so that I stands for integer, then have M for multiplication and division, you have A for the atomics, you have F for single floats, D for double floats, quads for quad floats, C for compressed. So there are different modules, I will mention. And basically, the way the software is developed, you have, you know, predefined target, which is usually is RV64GC. And that's, so where the GC is defined by the Unix spec. So the Linux, VBSD, whatever, everyone's targeting that RV64GC target. And that's, yeah. And if you want to have a Linux-capable chip, your chip needs to support including compressed instructions. So none of the distros, including Fedora, of course, does not support chips that have not compressed instructions available. As far as I know, there's only one chip taped out from the Indian Shakti team, which doesn't have a compressed instruction, but the next one's supposed to have. So yeah, it's a bit cryptic. Basically known as RISC-V64, and that's it. But it's the same name, RISC-V64GC, which expands to a very long name, and that long name can also expand to even a longer one, which includes the minor and major revisions in the ECI string. Oops.
Bücherregale, ja, aber habe ich eigentlich genug. Wie baut man die denn am schnellsten ab?
So again, if you have a very quick look at the what you can get, we have 32 registers. The first register is also hardwired to zero. Most instructions are going to be 52-bit length, and if you have a compressed, both going to be 16-bit. So some of very popular instructions can be compressed into 16-bit. Because you have multiple extensions, you can build a chip with different extension, different pieces. It also means that you have different APIs. You have a lot of APIs. So the one that they're using in Fedora, and which is the default in the GPU, is called a V64E. That being 64-bit, it has everything up to the double floats. Yes, you have a PC, which is at the bottom. Yeah, you have a register. So building Fedora is complicated because you need a Fedora to build a Fedora. So it's a difficult problem. The way you solve that, you kind of tend to build a very minimal UFS file system, and you want to get the RPM build, and then start from that building something, and after many, many iterations, starts looking like Fedora. So it looks something like this. You build your core operating chain, so binutils, GCC, take a lot of common projects like bash, sed, and stuff like that, and you attempt to build a very minimal but suitable and under KVM file system. And you want to get an RPM. So you want to get the basics. It's not going to look correct. It might not work correctly. It's probably going to be missing a lot of stuff. So you're going to start adding stuff to your UFS. And at the same time, you're going to start taking those SRPMs from the cache and start using RPM build to attempt to rebuild it. So you want to rebuild that small UFS from the RPMs at some point. So that involves a lot of hacking, going back, doing all the worst things that you're not allowed to do in Fedora, but you have to do that to get to the point that it's going to look like Fedora. And at some point, you might be very likely to start where you can actually import those packages into your Kaji and start building more, in a similar way that you do in Fedora. So the first time it started basically in almost 3 years ago, or let's say exactly 3 years ago. Troy Richard from Red Hat Mobilization Group, and just a few days after I joined, Stefan joined. Over a few months, we built like 5,000 packages, and we had a somewhat Fedora-looking system. Richard had a lot of blog posts, so if you want to look exactly what was happening, you can look into those links below. So the project stopped, so a lot of stuff are not final, so and there was a breakage in API, and it meant that whatever we built is not exactly what we can use anymore. So the idea was to stop and wait till the final Julius patches emerged and restart our work. That took some time. It was finalized, and at the end of 2017, before those changes landed, Richard already started testing them. And then after finally landed, almost very close to the FOSDEM, we started fully building before the final time bootstrapping the Fedora distro. And about in mid-April 2018, I got the Kaji running, we imported our packages, and we started actually pulling the source RPM from official Kaji and starting to build that. Of course, if you look at whatever we had before with Kaji, it was a mix of Fedora 25 till 28. It was very, very complicated beast. And up till now, you're not using Kaji Shadow, so packages are not built in the same order, but you're building official Fedora. So that comes with some problems. So building a distro just for fun, maybe you can do it. I don't know if bootstrapping could be called fun, but I think that the fun comes from when you start seeing it's being used in real life. People use it, people are doing something with it, people showing something with it. So let's look at a few pictures, I guess. So the first time we booted Fedora in the real hardware, so that's at the sci-fi offices in San Mateo, California. There is a sci-fi board connected to the Xilinx FPGAs, this FMC connectors, you know, and the cable goes to the box, which has extra PCI Express devices. You have a keyboard and a mouse and a GPU attached, so you get a nice display, not a serial console on your laptop. And it's the first time they actually booted Fedora 28, and they're doing an upgrade on the system. And they're actually running that off as SSD. That's the first time that Fedora landed on the real physical hardware. So we got some boards. So Sci-Fi seeded various development boards, the different projects, distros, major programming languages, and stuff like that. So Richard has two boards. One is official Fedora board, another one is his private board. DJ from GLibC has another one, and that's the picture on the right. So again, it's a similar setup. It's probably the most expensive way to attach a CD, probably $6,000 to attach a CD, but at least you don't need to deal with NFC or NVD or whatever network is file storage. So when I was at Sci-Fi and we first booted Fedora, the same night I started working on GNOME desktop. It took a while, but the same year we got it actually running. It was surprising because it worked out of the box. We spent several days trying to figure out one major issue. We didn't have a mouse and a keyboard working. It was a very stupid thing. Nothing, just us being dumb, I guess. But yeah, other than that, it worked. So it boots into initial setup. You set it up so just as after normal install, and it works. So Western Digital started using it in demos. There is a NAS demo. It's nice to work. So this one doesn't use the Xilinx FPGA. There is an extension board. So what that extension board gives you, it gives you the ability to have SSDs, M.2 SSDs, and PCI Express. Another thing, you can actually boot Fedora 29 in X11 mode or in CLI mode on your browser. So Billard has a project called JLinux. And he has the multiple images available on the internet, so if you have a Chrome or Firefox, you can go to web and just boot it, play with it. Then you can install anything on your system, but don't expect high performance. It's basically based on a TinyEMU, which used to be called the RISC-EMU. So we used to support that, and that was the first emulator to actually support graphics outputs. At the time, a TinyEMU couldn't do any display output. This was done yesterday, so the way I encourage at least new users to use Fedora 5 is you use libvirt. If you go with a QEMU, you need to pass a lot of things. Everything in Fedora 30 by default should work. As far as I know, I tested everything built in, so it should work out of the box, including a display output. If you wanna do some more testing, you can go and use the main SIG copper repository to pull the latest stuff, latest libvirt, latest virt manager, latest whatever, QEMU builds to play with it. So yeah, so the support is everywhere. I tested at least two device outputs for VGA and Bosch display, that's both work. We also somewhat recently switched from Virtio MMO to Virtio PCI. So that's nice. So all the devices are now connected to PCI Express. If you run libvirt, you get the proper networking. You don't need to set up any bridges or anything. So, and all the infrastructure that you're running now is fully libvirt based. So there's also the news article for the open. We actually had the 10 minutes video of how to build the RISC-V PC, and that's also uses Fedora GNOME desktop. So basically, as you can see, people start using it. It's not just a small CLI thing that you can run another QEMU. You can actually have a large-scale libvirt QEMU-based setups. You can boot into a GNOME desktop, but you can use it. You actually can also play Quake 2 if you have hardware. You can play Quake 2. But yeah, I had a match. It's decent performance. Had no problems. So the current state, so we have a Kaji build farm, so that's a very nice thing to do. We don't have a script that just goes from A to B to Z, whatever, and attempts to build all the packages. So the current build farm has three physical boards. A couple of them are using NVDs to load the FES. One is using SSD. We have one x86-64 node, so that's a main Kaji server. It has everything. The main Kaji storage, all the elements, database, everything. We have another virtual node with the sub-storage, which is used for backing up the whole configurations and the Kaji storage in case something happens, and we literally had to use it to recover the database, so backups are very important. We're running 94 KMU instances today, so those are all 4-core 8 gigs, most some are 8-core and 32 gig instances. And everything is managed by Lizard. We have a new server coming, so it's already running. We just need to finish the configuration, finish the storage, and we can actually probably grow even more. So there are some discussions to add more human instances. On both, so we're mixing the boards with the human instances. Yeah. No, we're not cross-built. No, we are running emulation, so we have virtual machines to QEMU. Yes, of course. There's no. So right now, there is a patch that's being upstream from KVM support. So technically, Vector Digital already proved that you can launch multiple virtual guests on a RISC-V system. So that's being upstreamed right now. But considering the strength of the hardware, you don't probably want to run virtual machines in it, especially on the build farm. So we started doing a repository mirrors to official Fedora websites. If something goes terribly wrong, the disk images and all the source, the bug, whatever, all the RPMs are available, so someone can take that and kickstart a new Kaji instance. So at least some way to survive if something happens. So this is the current statistics from the Kaji poll last night. So we had 30, probably now 34,000 builds, I guess, by now. About 7,000 failed for very different reasons. Anything from overloaded main servers, cannot deliver RPMs, to generic errors, to RISC-V specific errors, to mistakes in building things in the wrong order, stuff like that.
Wow, sind da zwei
So
Höhlen
we're doing right
aneinander?
now master build.
Zwei
So this
Spalten.
month we did about
Krass.
9,000 packages already built successfully. There is one thing that you don't do, or we didn't do for most of the time, was we didn't run any tests. So when we started the Kaji instance, we only had 8 VMs, and doing tests was expensive. So we had to cut the tests to actually build more packages faster. So as we're increasing the number of builders, we can actually, so we have more bandwidth, so we can actually make our jobs longer and do more proper things. So all the tests are now enabled in the Kaji. So if you look at the numbers as a past them from 2019 and the numbers from today, most of the Fedora builds, surprisingly without testing, it works and you rarely get any kind of error. So yeah, so that's a good result. The major missing pieces today was upstream kernel was not able to boot on the board, so Firefly kernel can finally boot on the board. We didn't have LLVM client stack, and 9.0 RC1 already supports that. We don't have Rust, but of course client just happening means that Rust is going to happen very soon after, and there's no Golang. But that's also basically done. Carlos, I think she's from Red Hat. She's working on that, so she has a Golang port working. That includes a Docker, Kubernetes, OpenFS, and other pieces. It's being blocked because the Golang is supposed to cut the release, so it's basically frozen for adding new architecture. So we have problems. So the servers for the Kaji, what we have is basically very, very, very old. So we have memory issues, meaning we have I/O issues, especially if you want to do fast composes. That's really a terrible thing because you generate about like 150 gigs per repository. If you try to do like two Fedora cycles, it quickly becomes basically a project of moving data, like hundreds of gigs per day to different places. To solve that, we got a new server, so it's full NVMe storage, corporate stuff, you know, loads of IOs, loads of bandwidth. It's not being used yet until we fully can configure that and then can switch to that and finally start building fast new composes and images. Our subdomain was added into AES preload list, which means automatically we redirected to HTTPS, which is bad because of Akadi's configurator self-hosted SSL certificate, which of course no one has installed on the system, so people start complaining that you cannot access the website. And there is a DNS alias, fedora.rsvive.rocks, which solves most of the problems until we move to a new server. We still have problems with queuing instances, so every day I have to recreate some of the VMs because the CPU is full for some unknown reason. And the 5.2 and 5.3 kernels, using the current firmware, we have problems even more. Probably to be flushes, not fully properly working, and that causes extra instability in the kernels, which is being investigated by multiple companies right now to be solved. But we think that's a problem with the firmware that we built, and still being investigated where exactly the problem is. So if you're using the latest Fedora 5 images, you might get extra instability, so that it might crash in a few days if you're building, you know, being a long build. So just occasionally run it, you know, common stuff, boot it, tested something, short, it works fine. So the problem is if you spend all this time on infrastructure, then you have less time to deal with the actual porting stuff, you know, fixing release-related stuff, GA stuff. So what's missing? So we don't sign any RPMs. I somewhat consider that as a feature, so you don't shouldn't trust it yet. It's not up to the Fedora full standard, so that's one thing. Same as a Vert builder repository is not signed. If that's something that bothers you very much and you want to have it signed, it's possible to do, but considering our current server, we cannot do that, but once we move it, should have enough bandwidth to start signing RPMs.
Bandwidth.
We have no body. I don't think that we need it. We don't have no Kaji, so at this point, we are using, so Kaji is generating distribution repositories. It's also generating images. That works. It's basically the way that ARMv7 works. But in the future, we probably have to look into two things. So that's crunchy, if you want to have modularity and the whole MDS infrastructure, which I think there's no tutorial how to set it up, except the ensemble scripts. We don't produce workstation or server images. We probably could do that. And I'm going to talk about the different images that we produce later on. So yeah, so from the infrastructure point of view, it's going to be crunchy and modularity, because otherwise you're missing a chunk, you know, piece of Fedora. So for the boot stuff, we have no DLS, and Fedora is moving to DLS. I think ARMv7 might not have it. The good part is that we have a U-boot.
Ich habe keinen Helm.
It works on the physical hardware, and we just got a Grub 2.04, which also has RFI support. So technically, you should be able to use U-boot EFI and boot EFI binary of Grub 2, and then you stop here because kernel doesn't have any EFI stops at this point. That is on the list, but you know that's the only missing piece, and then plus bugs, of course. Do you get something, you know, the boot, getting the boot, which looks like AR64. So, because we do have a U-boot, that means we finally can actually install a new kernel on the U-boot, the QEMU instance, which was not the case before because you have to pass the binary directly to QEMU or libvirt. So that's a very nice addition. We didn't run, and again, we didn't run any tests, which we do now, so finally, because we do have a band, you should do that. So, custom bits. So we don't use a card shadow. That's probably my fault. I did try it once, I followed the configuration, you know, there was a wiki page from 2015, some to-do list of, you know, not fully described what how it's supposed to work. I did that, launched it, so I was paranoid and waited to the screen for like 1 hour or something. It was a lot of NDR to turn that, to play for a year NDR and stuff like that, and finally imported this into a package from February 12, and I killed it.
Weil die hätte ich noch ablenken und die auch.
So,
ach, kann ich dir kurz zurück.
Of how to set it up, but it doesn't go that deep, and I just want to have the results that it was in the Kaji, official Kaji, to get to my Kaji, not to go all the way to Dinosaur Age and try to, you know, import something that I don't want to have in my Kaji. We also didn't produce the Serbian packages the way the Kaji did, because that was expensive, so setting up a route takes 1 hour, and then you have to wait like 1 to 2 hours to get your SRPM, so that was done on, I say, the six target, you know, the doctor and the podman at the beginning. And you also had, you also didn't want to submit a package just that, you know, it's going to fail, because that's also expensive, especially if you have like 8 virtual machines. So I had my own script, kind of my own Kaji Shadow, which also, you know, pulled the DNF data from our Kaji, checked all the requirements, tried to figure out if we can get them, and then submit the bills. And the success rate of our build was like, you could hit like 90% of, which is quite good. We do have SCM overlay for this Git. That's a separate repository. It holds everything that I'm hacking on. So if the release has dot number dot RIS 5 before the disk, that means I did something to that package. So it's either a patch applied, which is not upstreamed, or upstreamed but not in the release, or I had to make changes to the spec file and it didn't get pushed into the disk git. So that's, you know, I changed something, but probably going to be a change log entry of what I did, and there is a separate SCM. And also, that means that I can make changes without, you know, waiting like 2 weeks to 4 weeks until someone, you know, reacts on a disk git. Disk images, so basically we're free now. There is a developer, what they call, which is like a kitchen sink. It has everything that you would like to do RPMs. It has no minimal X11 support, debuggers, Emacs, Vims, everything you might want to do, even manipulate virtual disk images. So the problem is if you want to boot the system and you want to get the package, you might need to wait 10 minutes to get it. And if you want to have like, you know, oh, I'm missing a Git, another 10 minutes. I'm missing my Vim, another 10 minutes. I'm missing that, another 10 minutes. So it's very annoying. DNF and parsing XML files, I believe, the last time you looked. But DNF is slow. So yeah, and there's the GNOME disk image, which basically developer plus whatever you needed to run the GNOME desktop. And there is the minimal. So some people don't want to spend, you know, download 1 gigabyte. We just need to boot and say that it works. So for example, virtualization people, we just need something small that boots. So that's basically, that's it. Again, we probably could build workstation or server at this point. I don't exactly see something blocking us, but it needs to be investigated. Yes.
Ja, was war denn hier los?
Ja,
hier war doch nicht schon jemand, oder? Das ist wahrscheinlich wieder einer dieser Bugs, der Blöcke abbaut.
Disk images, so we started to have a bless disk images, that means I take some image, I boot it, let's do a QEMU, I start playing with it, seeing if things working, you know, if everything on the systemd looks green. So most images are posted on Fedora project.org, so you can get both. You can pull direct images from the Kaji. If you want to look at all stage 4 disk images, that's also still available. We don't provide disk images for the board. So all because it didn't, there wasn't support on that stream kernel. I didn't want to pull in a large number of, you know, moving patches. So anyone who wanted to do the board, run Fedora on the board, they had to build their own kernel. This is going to be changing very soon because 5.3 can do that. So after we finish master build, how long? I don't know how long it's going to take yet. I'm going to start looking at the 5.3 kernel and actually having an image of it complete on the board out of the box. I also set up a root builder repository. Again, it's not a signed one, but it's your life easier because you can just have a root builder to generate your disk images, do modifications to it, and change the size, host, passwords, whatever. And then you can do root install to get it into your libvirt. And the only thing you need to extract from that disk image is your firmware block. So that's what is an OpenSDI with a U-boot. It's also available on a web page if you follow the first link on the disk images. It's also extracted, so if you don't want to deal with the disk images, you don't need to deal. So the target video supports the QEMU, libvirt QEMU setup, and we used to support, at least the older disk images also work with a TinyEMU, but we moved so far ahead that it's not fully working now. So if you pull an old Fedora image that's still going to work with TinyEMU, newer ones are not going to work. There's a physical board, as I mentioned, the 5.3 is going to support it, and we're going to do... so yeah, that's going to be in disk images as soon as we can finish the master build. And if you want to run this microextend expansion board, you're probably not going to have those patches in. So we're going to only support the board, not the old expansion stuff that you can add to it today. And all the instructions are available on the Fedora wiki page. So annoying bits, so config scripts. So config.guess instead of the still a case. So there is configure a macro which attempts to replace it. It's not always worked. So that's still a bit annoying. There is somewhat an issue with atomics. So RISC-V only supports what size atomics, and everything else goes from good atomic. And people tend to use minus L pthread, which is not the correct way to use. You have to use minus pthread, and that expands to different things in the different platforms. So apparently a lot of packages do that. So they use minus LP thread, and then that happens that you get undefined references to libatomic calls because the compiler is not going to take care of it. So the current GC does not inline those libatomic calls. You can fix that by manually linking to to libatomic, or you can probably, I'm somewhat considering, but not doing it yet, is actually replacing the P thread with linker script. A similar way like libc works. So it automatically includes as needed minus L atomic minus as not needed. So if you do use minus pthread on the RISC-V with a GCC, so GCC is going to do correct things to respect, and it's going to link minus L atomic. Another thing, for example, was the dynamic sections being read-only in the RISC-V. Other architecture that does that is MIPS, and then the tuning was happening in a glibc that was copied from the MIPS file. So technically that comment is wrong because the spec doesn't require it to be read-only, but now it's part of API. Another thing is that the library is lit in a bit different location. So you have /usr/lib64, and then you have an ABI. And again, they're using LP64D as an ABI. The way we solve that in the Fedora, we have a symlink to a parent directory, so that works. So we can use either the official RISC-V defined location for the library, so we can still use the same /lib64, and that still points to the same thing. And we found no problems with that. And many ideas, so again, we have to move to a new server. There's still ongoing discussions with the audit, so I upstreamed the audit framework in the kernel. The library in the user space is a bit blocked because the maintainer wants to refactor the library, doesn't want to take the tables for RISC-V architecture because then someone might not maintain them and then it's going to, you know, typical problems. The second patch also exists. I have it included in Fedora disk images. I have to send out the VQ version to the kernel mailer links list, but basically it works except one kernel self-test is failing, which is a new addition. So I still need to look. So we still have packages in this Git. We probably have 100 of them, which you still need to go and check and probably submit to this Git or push some patches to upstream. But that's, you know, going slow because infrastructure number one, so that's not running, so there's no Fedora required. And, you know, we had a lot of new changes. We have DLang now working. We have Ada compiler. We have FreePascal working. We have Haskell compilers. The missing pieces are Rust, LLVM Clang, which is basically done. Once it lands in official project, I'm going to pull that in, and that's going to work, or supposedly going to work. And the Golang, which also exists, but it's not yet merged because it's blocked by upcoming Golang release. I'm supposed to use Guardy Shadow, but I'm a bit afraid of it, again, because I'm not fully sure what it's going to do to the current Kaji state. We used to have a Berkeley bootloader before we had the proper firmware, which is, you know, OpenSDI and U-boot, so that's also solved, and you can install new kernels, you can reboot, and you don't need to kind of kill a VM, change your CLI arguments to a new kernel and boot it, so that's very nice, and officially produce the images for the board. And there are a number of companies that directly support Fedora 5, directly and not directly. So most of the servers that we use for builders are old Facebook servers today, hosted by GCC Compile Farm project. And SciFi donated the board, Tranquility donated the initial Kaji servers, backup servers, Western Digital also donated the storage for the new server. So a lot of individuals from Red Hat, companies, specs. So it's moving very fast and it's expanding very fast. So that's long. So questions. Changes for virtualization, so I don't think that the spec is frozen. Yes, so there's a key. So we started working on an implementation. There are some ideas how to improve the performance and stuff like that. So there's some discussions of what can be done and improved. It's still going to work, but you know, in the future it might work a bit more efficient. Yeah, well, the baseline is just integer. That's it. You don't get an atomic multiplication, it's called nothing. So that probably gets it. But basically, you can build a very, very minimal chip without anything much. Well, Linux is RB64GC. That's defined in the RISC-V Unix platform specification. So it's not instruction set. Instruction set defines a basic software target, which is RB64G. That's a G stands for integer multiplications, atomic, so, you know, defines a set of extensions that you want to have. And then the Unix spec defines that, you need also extra instructions, you need to, you know, this virtual memory stuff, you need this and that for your Linux system. It doesn't talk about that. So the spec is very short today. So RISC-V Foundation has started a task group to define, you know, have a very well-written document of what the Unix, and it's also named the Unix spec specification, but it's a bit wrong because we're going to have specification not only for the Unix-like systems, because, you know, beyond that, you might have a different profile for different kind of the systems you want to target, like embedded, or, you know, needs a different target. So that it's not frozen. So again, there's a working group, a task group, in the RISC-V Foundation, which is working on that specification. This also includes an OpenSDI or SDI supervisor binary interface, firmware interface, basically. So that's still very much moving target. So we just needed to have something as a base. So it ended up being like two paragraphs at the beginning. It was reformatted recently, but it haven't moved very far from that. So it's very basic, not like something that could be at some ARM. have a custom patches? Yes. There is no hard translation. So, yeah. So the way that sci-fi at least compares the chip to the current sci-fi release board is, I think it's U54 cores. There are 4 cores of that, and that performs like a Cortex-A50. And the next generation U74, I think, is being marketed as similar to Cortex-A55. The way we found it, but surprisingly not. Well, it depends on your host machine. But if you compare our builder systems, you find that the board is still faster, like building kernels. So if you have a very complicated like C++ project, the board is still better than running on a QEMU. Well, unless again you have like high performance Intel and the chip can push it like 5.2 GHz or something. In that case, I don't know the numbers, but you might be a performance of the board, or maybe even better. You can go up to 8 cores on the QEMU instance. That's the limit. So my suggestion was that here to build the team something maybe like Linaro Developer Cloud, so that people can actually get some allocations of the board to run the CIs, do you know forwarding or performance checks. Today that's not the case. Sci-Fi was the first company to seed the development boards, physical boards, for free to like Debian, Golang people, to anyone who's working on some major project could get the physical board. So we can have direct access to it. The rest, it depends. I mean, yes, I mean, I would like to have that. I mentioned that, but we don't have it yet. And I'm not sure if it's going to be in the future. But I think that would be great. So this, which it checks my card genesis, and if my card genesis has a newer package, or does anyone plan to write a full documentation for Kaja Shadow? That would be great. Yeah, so that was my idea. The only way to figure out what the Kaja Shadow is doing, just take a code on, you know, and read it. So yeah, so I think in the future, Kaji Shadow is something that you need if you want to ever become an official secondary architect. Yeah. So I would kind of want to avoid it, but I can't avoid it. Yeah, that would be great. And you could update the Wiki page too, maybe. So just to go works, that's the first thing we tried and that works. There might be a smallish issue within the Fedora in the future related to libf5. So the problem is that Fedora uses the last official release, which apparently some distros don't even use because the libf5 is not being released and the maintainer is very slow, I believe. So the RISC-V is merged in, it's even attached to the original copy of the libf5, so at some point it would be nice if the Fedora could bump to something, to a Git version, you know, specific Git commit of a little file, because I don't expect to have any release in the next whatever few years, if ever. Well, that's an interesting question. I think we are the first ones. So we work very close with Debian, believe it or not, but I would say that Fedora is part of the Debian and Fedora baby. you're going to even find the Debian people in the Fedora Spark channel, and we're discussing all the things. We had more bandwidth, so human power to push it through. So I think we got in a better shape, and we still maybe delivering some things faster than Debian. But they, again, I'm not fully sure because I'm not running Debian. But I was working with it full time for 4 years, so I had the bandwidth to push things faster. Fedora, to some people, are interesting, mainly Rawhide, so it's a fast-moving target. So we want to be too fast in this case. And for example, my this Git overlay allows me to be too fast. Whereas a package someone comes in and says we need it for academic research, or I'm a developer and I need that, you know, then that's what I can do without actually waiting, you know, whatever it takes, weeks, days, or whatever to get that in a busy day, even if it's not yet fully married or something. For example, I am planning to add the Golang and not waiting for the next Golang release, for example, because people want to use it. So there's no board specification, but the sci-fi board has the V9 chip, which stores one of the things called FSBL bootloader, which also has a DTD file, which can be flashed in your build, which might, may or may not be replaced in the future with open boot SBL. So in that case, you most likely want to end up in the Spark Foundation last month specification task group and say that, you know, that's something you want to put in spec. So today, I don't have an idea how to support multiple boards. So, I mean, there's a single board. There is an Andes platform that also has a U-boot and MMC support, so technically could do that, but we don't produce chips. They are the same as the sci-fi, they are targeting a custom solutions. So, but only sci-fi released a chip that can be used by developers. That so the boot stuff is not being yet defined. It's being worked also part of that working group, as far as I know. So if you want to define, you want to have some concerns, that's where you should raise them. Other than that, RISC-V was added to ACPI, UFI, Redfish, and PC by specs. There is a channel port which you can boot on a FPGA chip and get into a shell. There is a GRUB 2.04 which also supports RISC-V API, and the U-boot also supports the RISC-V. Again, the only missing piece in the kernel view is the RISC-V subs. Has to be at some point, and again, it's a work in progress. If you have concerns about where you're supposed to, the best place to raise it, or at least on the various open mailing list, if that's what you like to have, and you know, what is your reasoning? I personally don't expect to have a full channel for running on the boards. The best I could expect is something EDBR-like. My target, my personal target, is something that the R60 core has. Slowly moving towards that. More questions? Okay, thank you.
Okay Leute, das war Fedora's 564-Bit, a 3-year-long journey von David Abudin. Von David, von der Vlog 2019 auf dem Fedora Project Channel. Ja, und wir spielen hier auf dem Minecraft-Server LaserGurkenLand, gratis und öffentlich erreichbar unter der IP-Adresse 149.202.137.134. Alternativ unter der Domain sillyhuhn.com und ja, wir sehen uns auf dem Server, hoffe ich doch. Oder zur Not in der nächsten Folge der Dauerwerbesendung.